In this video, we're going to talk about interpretive phenomenological analysis. It's an approach used in qualitative research, which isn't just about the analysis stage itself, but is something that influences the whole research design, including the methods and how you ask questions of your participants. So we're going to go over today some of the misconceptions, some of the differences with other approaches like grounded theory, and how you can make sure you do good IPA for your study. So interpretive phenomenological analysis really grows from psychology. Although it's used in lots of other disciplines, it's important to remember that root because a lot of the time it is a kind of psychological analysis. What we're doing in interpretive phenomenological analysis is trying to understand participants' own worldview and how they make sense of their lives and experiences. A key part of interpretive phenomenological analysis is trying to help participants with hermeneutics, and that's really translation or interpretation, and we're trying to understand how participants make sense of what happens in their world. It's sometimes in IPA called double hermeneutics, because not only is the participant trying to understand the world, the researcher themselves are also trying to understand how the participant is understanding their world. So there's two layers of analysis going on: the participant's own interpretation of what's happening, and then the researchers on top of that as well. When we're talking about phenomenology in interpretive phenomenological analysis, what we're talking about is real-world interactions with events or objects, which we use kind of as a lightning rod to understand how participants are making sense of their lives and their own identity. And this notion of identity is often very important in IPA. And it's that kind of understanding of participants' own interpretation of events, whether they see that as being fate or something they have control over, whether it's something that makes them feel powerless or empowered. That's the kind of level of psychological analysis that we often do as part of IPA. And then we sometimes want to go a little bit beyond that. We want to understand why a participant sees themselves in a particular way, why they feel powerless about a certain thing. So basically, as the participant is trying to understand their own lives, we're trying to understand them. So because of this kind of psychological approach, it's quite important to understand that IPA isn't something that you can just decide to do when you come to the analysis stage, when you've already done your data collection. It needs to be an integral part of the project. You really need to make sure that the methods you choose and the questions you ask are going to help that participant understand their worldview and their own reflexivity. When we come to analyze qualitative data using IPA, there are a bunch of similarities with some of the other common approaches like grounded theory and thematic analysis, where what we're trying to do is, first of all, reflect on our own reflexivity, so our own understandings of the world, our own epistemology, our own positionality as a researcher, and how that might influence how we're interpreting the data. So when it comes to doing the actual analysis with IPA, one of the important things is just to be familiar with the transcripts first. You should read and reread them and make sure that you have a good sense of the story and the narrative, some of the main things which the participant's talking about, before you start doing that first kind of exploratory coding yourself. And then the next thing is we generally start the analysis with very little preconceived notion of what we expect to find in the data. It's an open-ended approach where we interpret the data kind of with fresh eyes and try to be open to the interpretation. So we don't have a set framework before we start. We're trying to generate theory most of the time that will answer our research question. So that's the kind of commonality with a lot of thematic analysis and grounded theory approaches. However, one of the most commonly cited things about IPA is the fact that it seems to take a line-by-line approach. In other words, for each line of the transcripts from our interviews, we're trying to find a brief kind of exploratory comment, a little note which summarizes the participant's own kind of feelings or positionality. But in fact, when you start to look at the literature, especially by Smith, who's kind of the most famous writer in this area, you'll find that it doesn't actually specify a line-by-line approach. It says that the unit of analysis should be flexible, and it might sometimes be a line, it might be a sentence, it might be part of a sentence, it might be a whole paragraph. So although a lot of time you'll see articles which basically equate IPA with taking a line-by-line approach, that's not really the defining feature of it, and in fact doesn't have to be done like that. So you can be flexible to interpret things, and you don't have to have something for every line. If someone's saying something which doesn't reveal something about their own psyche, then you don't have to interpret it and have one of those exploratory notes for it. Usually the process is then that you go through the whole participant's interview, go through the transcript, do those kind of own reflexive notes. And in many ways, that's quite similar to approaches like in vivo coding, where you use the participant's own words to summarize what they're saying. But with IPA, we don't have to do that. We don't have to use the participant's own words. We can use our own interpretation, our own hermeneutics of the participant, basically doing our own kind of reflexive writing. We're using those little notes, those little comments, to go through the whole interview, not line by line, certainly section by section, and understand the main things that people are talking about. And we're really kind of doing a kind of psychoanalysis approach there with IPA. We're looking for instances where the participant may talk about their own identity, internal struggle, their emotions, their sense of self and self-belief. And those are the kind of things that are going to generate those exploratory comments. When we've done that, it's similar to other qualitative research paradigms in that we have a second stage. In something like grounded theory or thematic analysis, this will be similar to the open and axial coding. First, we create kind of quite simple codes to summarize what people are saying, and then we develop larger exploratory themes. And that's the same for IPA as well. Once we've gone through the whole transcript, we then use those exploratory comments, the things that we wrote kind of along the side, the column, to then develop larger, broader themes. In the literature, these are called emergent themes. These are generally broader and wider topics, and they will also have some kind of connection, again, to that kind of lived experience, but also help us understand the psychology of the participant. In this second stage, we'll have much less than this kind of line-by-line approach. We'll have much fewer, possibly paragraph-by-paragraph interpretations, and in general, those should be kind of creating new ideas, new interpretations, and helping us get to answer our research question. And then we'll later go on, after we've done that for different participants, and see if there are commonalities if we're working with a group of people. In general, because the approach tends to be very individualistic, and we're kind of trying to understand an individual's interpretations of self, it's unusual to do some methods like focus groups, where they're kind of group work. It does happen sometimes, but in-depth interviews, semi-structured interviews, tend to be the main data collection tool for IPA. So let's have a look at some examples about what it might actually look like to do IPA. Now, a lot of the time people will use a common software tool like Word or Excel to do IPA. So you can imagine if you're using Excel or a table in Word, you basically have one column which has the participant's own transcripts of what they're saying, another one which has your exploratory comments, and then another one along the side of that which has your emergent themes. So you're kind of going from left to right or right to left, but developing a higher level theory through there. However, there are great advantages to using qualitative analysis software tools like Quirkos. You can do this same kind of approach in Quirkos using the memos or comments feature to create those initial exploratory comments. And then later on, you can use the codes or themes, the bubbles, to actually generate those exploratory themes later. And you can connect those directly to your exploratory comments. The advantage to using software is also that it makes it a lot easier when you come to do the writing up. It's a lot quicker to find something by theme or on a similar comment. You can obviously search across the whole thing, and it's very easy to get quotes out when you're writing up that kind of give an illustration about your themes and your comments and some of the findings that you want to report, whether you're writing up a thesis or a journal article. So I hope this video has been useful. We have a lot of other resources on our YouTube channel, including tutorials to do other types of analysis and some advice and guidance on data collection and other aspects of qualitative research. We also have a blog with more than 200 articles on all kinds of different parts of the qualitative analysis journey. And of course, there's also Quirkos itself, a simple qualitative analysis tool that lets you do analysis like IPA using its built-in memos and comments feature. And the unique bubble interface helps you really create themes, put them together, and explore your data in a very visual and creative way. So do sign up for the free trial. You get 2 weeks free with no commitment. You can cancel at any time and see if it's going to work for your IPA approach.